who was found guilty of murder. And he was sentenced to a life sentence in prison. But new evidence came to play. New things happened in the court system. And later he was transferred and paroled to work on a farm near Nashville, Tennessee. And then something happened almost 20 years later in 1968. Currier's sentence was terminated. It was over. And a letter bearing the good news was sent to him. It was terminated. You are free. But John never saw the letter. He never received the letter, nor was he ever told about the letter. It's truly sad because what happens is he then continued to work on that farm. And what's really sad about it is that often many of us find ourselves in relationships where we hope we could get beyond things that imprison us, unrighteous relationships, misunderstanding, situations in our own homes or on our jobs where we feel imprisoned. We find ourselves in situations where it feels like a life sentence with what we are going through. Even when God makes a way out of no way, where he gives us a chance of grace and forgiveness. And in God's word, he has written us letters. Letters that tell us what can be done, what has been done to terminate the frustration, to terminate the anger, to terminate the wrongdoing, and pronounce to us, you can be healed. You don't have to maintain and sustain unhealthy and unholy relationships any longer. You can be free. But if these words and if this wisdom is not delivered, if it's not received, then those unrighteous relationships continue to be fed and bred in those relationships. Our text tells us if another believer sins against you, go privately and point out the offense. And many times we read these words of Paul as if they are a condemnation, as if he's dropping a dime on somebody, as if to say, okay, somebody did something wrong in church, and this is his way of condemning a wrong. But he is saying, when there's something wrong in a relationship, you just can't keep ignoring it. In fact, these words warn us to be aware of being in a relationship with someone that refuses to express their sins. The text goes on to say, if another person listens and confesses of that sin, then you have won that person back. These words then are warning us that not only beware of relationships when someone refuses to express their sin, but also be aware if a person refuses to confess their sin, because that unrighteous relationship will continue to fester. And then finally, the opening of that text falls out and says, then if he or she won't accept the church's decision, treat that person as a pagan or a corrupt tax collector. And these words are warning us that to not only beware of relationships in which someone refuses to express their sins and confess their sins, but also beware when someone refuses to repress their sins. By repress, it means that is to say that they won't try to clean up their act. They continue to confuse and abuse the relationship. But then our text does something completely different that takes us in another direction. Where it not only gives us advice about what to do when things go wrong in our relationship, but it also shares insights of what to do to make the wrong things right. make waves. And we have misunderstandings and arguments that could have been handled in 1 or 2 days, and 20 years later, we're still arguing and fussing about the same thing because we didn't want to make waves. And instead, we let a tidal wave take over our lives. Listen to the advice of Paul in the beginning of that 18th verse of the Amplified Version. It says, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you forbid and declare to be improper or unlawful on earth must be what is already forbidden in heaven. And whatever you permit and declare proper and lawful on earth must be what is already permitted in heaven." We are here. If it's not allowed up there, it shouldn't be allowed down here. If it is allowed up there, that's what we should be allowing down here. One day a man purchased a white mouse. And he bought it, it always bothered me when I go into pet stores and I see people buy mice and fish to feed their other pets. But it's, I guess, as Disney would say, the circle of life. And he bought this white mouse to feed his pet snake. And he took this white mouse and he put it in the terrarium. And when the white mouse realized there was a snake that was there, the mouse started taking the wooden chips because he saw that the snake was sleeping. So he started taking the chips and covering up the snake. Until finally, when he got finished, the snake was completely covered. And then the mouse got back in the corner and just relaxed. Because the snake is now buried alive. It's put away. It can no longer bother me. The problem is solved. Yet the truth is, no matter how hard we try, too often we are just like that mouse. The truth is, no matter how hard we try to cover up our sins, it's fool's work. Because sin will eventually awaken from the sleep and shake off the cover and will destroy us. Just covering up that which is there is not enough to save us. Just trying to make waves is not enough to make that problem go away. In our relationships, God wants us to love one another. We've seen that text how many times where in 1 Corinthians, he tells us he wants us to love one another. When he talks about love is patient, love is kind. You've heard me teach it before, but be aware of this. If we really look at all of that, verses 4 through 12, there are 8 things in that text that it actually teaches us that love does. It tells us love is not a noun. It's a verb. Don't just come here and tell me, "I love you." Do me love. Too many people will say, "I love you," bam. "I love you," bam. Don't hit me again. Don't tell me you love me while you're treating me in an unloving fashion. Paul teaches us that love is patient. Love is kind. Love, it rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up. Love never loses faith. Love is always hopeful. Love endures through every circumstance. Love will last forever. 8 things. These are what love will do. It's like a litmus test. When I am treated this way, you are showing me love is in the room. That's what love does. But 1 Corinthians 13, it also warns us about 8 actions that love does not do. 8 things that says, when these actions are going on, love has left the premises. For even if you feel you love me, you are not sharing it in a loving way. It's like saying, "I love you," and then picking up my Bible and beating you in the head with it until you believe me. It's not enough to tell me you believe me, you love me. You must show me that you love me. But Paul tells us 8 things. Love is not jealous. Love is not boastful. Love does not keep bragging about itself. Love is not rude. Love does not demand its own way. And when these eight actions keep showing up and bearing and sharing themselves in a relationship, love is not being fed nor bred in the relationship. And like the mouse in the sawdust, we just keep covering up the proverbial snake in the glass and in the grass, thinking we are safe, ignoring the problem, when the truth is sooner or later, it's going to wake up. And when it does, it will do its best to destroy us and devour us. If someone is in a relationship, then, that not only refuses to express their sins, but also refuses to confess their sins, before you can fix that fractured relationship, you must not only, one, rectify your relationship, understanding and saying, I'm doing what God would want me to do on earth and heaven. You must not only rectify your relationship, you must clarify your partnership. The text goes on to say, again, I tell you, if two of you on earth agree, that is to harmonize together, make a symphony together about whatever, anything and everything, they may ask, It will come to pass and be done for them by my Father in heaven. In other words, like playing in an orchestra, we don't have to play the same instrument the same way. We don't have to play the same melody, even in the same key, or even in the same rhythm, for all that we do to be in harmony. But if the composer, which is Jesus, gives us our parts to play, and we are conducted by the same person, and that conductor is the Holy Spirit, then all that you do will be in harmony, and the angels in heaven will sing with you the chorus, and God will applaud what you are doing and say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You know, it's shameful how often our relationships fail simply because we don't clarify. We don't stay in our lane. We don't take the time to listen to God and talk to each other in order to understand our roles, our reasoning, and our relationships. I remember reading some insights shared once by Chuck Swindoll that he was talking about what he had learned about geese when they were in flight. And what I remember, there were four insights that really helped me to understand what a little bit more about the relationship that should be there with Christians when we are flying through life together. The first thing that he shared was that the first habit that they have when they are flying, they fly in a V formation. And when the bird in front gets tired, that goose rotates their leadership. He or she won't try to stay in front when they're tired. They realize, I can't continue this. I need some help. And that bird will fall back and another goose will get in front. Too many of us, when we can't handle the leadership, try to stay there. But that bird will pull back and say, I'm still here. I'm still supporting. Let's switch this thing up so we can get where we are going. Secondly, a habit that they have, you can learn from the geese, is that when they are in that situation, one goose will lead them, and when he gets tired and he changes place in that big situation, you see, by flying that way, each flaps their wings, and when they do, it shifts the air current, and by positioning that leader, by pulling back and putting himself in a particular shape in that V formation, they cause a wind uplift. And that bird can all of a sudden just stop flapping. And it can cut down 71% what he or then you must not only rectify that relationship and clarify your partnership, you must testify about discipleship. There is a verse that I think is one of the most misunderstood verses in scriptures. It's the one where it says, if they do not, in our text, if they do not stop doing what they should do, the church should treat them like a pagan or an unrighteous, corrupt tax collector. And so we see someone in our body that has truly made a mistake and messed up like the prodigal son. And so we shut the door, we throw them out, we shun them, say, you are a pagan, you are no longer one of us. But the truth is, in verse 20 it says, where two or three gather together as my followers, Jesus said, I am there among them. I am among them. That Greek, it refers back to the Hebrew where it says, I am. And Moses says, what shall I call you? What shall I tell the people your name is? And he says, tell them I am. Which means when you are doing the will of God, he is in the midst of us. His character, his will, and his love. In other words, we are to live our lives in such a Christ-like way that his presence, his principles, his power, and his peace is present in our relationship. So how are we to treat a pagan? Just like Jesus. He was known for being there with the wine bibbers and the prostitutes. I close. You remember me telling you about about John Currier back in 1949 and how he spent 20 years on that farm working until finally, unfortunately, after a judge sent him and terminated his parole and said, you are free. But he never got the letter. And so he continued to work. Not only did he continue to work, but when the farmer died on the farm he was working with and somebody else took over, he was sold with the farm and he had to continue to work. 20 years. Until finally there was a parole officer that came by and realized after 10 years beyond what he should have done, now making it 30 years, said, don't you realize a letter was sent and you were set free a decade ago? And you're still acting like a criminal who has been committed to a life sentence? The question of the hour, beloved, is would it matter to you if someone sent you an important message like that? The most important message in your life, and years of this urgent message that told you you were free of your guilt, free of your shame, free of the unforgiving ways that you felt. What would you feel like if that letter was never delivered to you and you stayed a slave to your sins? We who have heard the good news and experienced freedom through Christ are responsible to proclaim it to others who are still enslaved by sin. We are the ones who have been told to go out and give people the message. The judge has freed them, but they're still working in their sin. And likewise, when Christ died on the cross, the Lord made a way to suspend our sins and our sentence. But many of us in the world and in the church are still keeping their guilt alive and well. The text said, if the person still refuses to listen, treat that person as a pagan or a corrupt tax collector. Beloved, how would Jesus treat them? Again, he was known for hanging around wine bibbers. waiting like the Father is with compassion and love to bring them back in the fold. That's how you treat them. But Pastor, they did me wrong. Pastor, how am I supposed to treat them in this horrible relationship? Jesus said, love your enemies. And you may look at me and say, how can I love someone that I don't even like? I've already read it to you. It is something you can do like Christ to those you love and those you hate. Be patient. Be kind. Rejoice when the truth wins out. Never give up. Never lose faith. Always be hopeful. Endure in every situation. Last, let God's truth last in you forever, because that's the definition of love. And all you gotta do is choose to rectify your relationship, clarify your partnership, and testify about true discipleship. For only then